The caption for this morning message: Escape and run for your life. Escape and run for your life. I just read a Bible passage to you. Genesis chapter 19, from verse 16 through 18. Verse 16. And when he lingered, when Lot lingered, the man laid hold upon his hand, and upon the hand of his wife, and upon the hand of his two daughters, the Lord being merciful unto him. And they brought him forth and set him without the city. They brought him forth and set him without the city. And it came to pass, when they brought them forth abroad, that he said, that one of the angels said, Escape for thy life. Escape and run for thy life. Look not behind thee, neither stay thou in all the plain. Escape to the mountain, lest thou be consumed. Escape from Sodom, escape from Sodom, escape to the mountain, lest thou be consumed. And Lot said unto them, Oh, not so, my Lord. Oh, not so, my Lord. When the Lord brings you out of Sodom, out of the city, out of the world life, two things are essential. Escape from the city, Sodom. Escape to the mountain God has chosen for you. Escape from the city. Escape from the city and escape to the mountain. But Lot said, Oh Lord, no Lord. I remember one sermon I preached when I was in ACA. The end of the just man. The end of the just man. The end of Lot. One of the just men recorded in the Bible. Became miserable. He escaped from the city. He didn't escape to the mountain. My dear brother, my dear sister, what the Lord has burdened with me, I'm going to share with you. Just reading a number of Bible verses, Bible passages, bringing back those passages to your mind, bringing those passages to your mind. Please listen. Please listen. They are not new. These passages are not new. But nevertheless, the Lord wants me to bring these passages back to your mind. Remembering them, bringing them back to our active memory. Number one, we read in Acts chapter 2 verse 40. And with many other words did he testify and exhort. Peter testified and exhorted, saying, Save yourselves from the untoward generation. Number one, which is very, very important. Save yourself from the untoward generation. Now these are new converts. They are mostly from Judaistic religion. They all were worshipping Yahweh God. Their religion was also from God. They got their own festivals, they got their own identities, they got their own worship patterns, and at least by that time, that religion was nearly 2,000 years old, and solidly more than 1,500 years old. More than 1,500 years old, very strong religion. They got their own worship pattern. They got their own rabbis. They got their own understanding of Messiah, their religion, their customs, their festivals. Now a group of people received Jesus Christ as their personal Savior from that background. And now Peter says, flee yourself from the untoward generation. Are they sinners? Are they murderers? Are they rogues? No, they are religious people. But they are untoward. Their idea is different. Their idea about moksha is different. Their idea about vimoshanam is different. Their idea about rakshipu is different. Their idea about penance is different. Their idea about sacrifices are different. Now you've got salvation in the name of Jesus. They are not yet saved. They don't believe the salvation through the name of Jesus. They are untoward. Their identity is different. Their festivals are different. They celebrate Christmas in a different way. Or they may have Deepavali. All these festivals may have a good meaning, good philosophy. But you cannot accept those practices. They are untoward. They are not murderers. They are not rogues. They are not wicked people. They are children of God. They are children of God. They are children of God. But their practices are different. Their practices are different. My dear brother, my dear sister. They are untoward. So Peter says, separate yourself from those who are untoward. Those who have got different ideas, different concepts. Their marriages are different. Their funerals are different. Their festivals are different. The idea of celebrating birthdays are different. Flee from them. Depart from them. And join with the people, those who interpret their lifestyles spiritually. We need that escaping from the city, escaping to the mountain. We want to do everything in a meaningful way. Why I do this? Why I do this? We learn from saints. We make mistakes. I remember it happened in our life. We are coming from CSI background. And we took Christy for dedication. We took Christy for dedication. So for the dedication ceremony, I was working. I was working in a school. I was translating Pastor Sundaram. When Christy was born, probably I was 27. I was 27. Sister was 25. So we invited our relatives, our sisters, her brother, and two of our friends. So they all came for their dedication service. We wanted to give them lunch. After the service, after the dedication service, after the whole morning service, we went to a small hotel called the Silver Stars. I don't think that hotel is there now. Near this Dufton Cafe. Anybody remember Silver Star? Oh, many of you remember. Very good. Very ordinary small hotel. Somebody, only few families, nobody else. My sisters, Sister Prami's brother, one more family I think. Somebody went and told Pastor Sundaramaya that we went for lunch. What a wonderful thing. It's really good. Very evening he called us. Na, dedication mudichittu virundhukku poningala? We went for lunch. In Silver Stars, we went for lunch. Dedication, anadharima? Parents must fast and pray. Parents must fast and pray. Adhan dedication. We learn. I was not offended. So it's not that what others do, how I should do. So the more we separate from others, the more we come closer to the Word of God. It's not going to hotel is wrong, but what's my motive? What is dedicating my child? Leave him on the altar. My dear brother, my dear sister. So in celebrating Christmas, in celebrating, observing the weddings, whatever it may be, we have to separate ourselves from that the errant world. That's why we read in Romans chapter 16 verse 17. Romans 16, 17. Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you have learned, and avoid them. And avoid them. So the Bible says, mark them which cause divisions. You learn certain things. You know what's baptism. You know what is holiness. You know what is grace. You know what is second coming. Here we see some people cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you have learned. Doctrine which you have learned. So here Paul says, avoid them. Now in TV, all sorts of programs come. Somebody will say, oh, you can sin. There is nothing called sin. In the cross, all your sins are forgiven. Now you are not under the dispensation of law. You are in the dispensation of grace. In grace there is no sin. The law is already done with. And when Christ is in you, you know what is right or wrong. What you do is right. What you do is right. Even if it is a sin, you don't worry about it. Where the sin abounds, grace will also abound. If you don't make any mistake, how can grace will abound to you? There will be one teaching like that. When you come to the church, your pastor will say, oh, what's the teaching of the grace? If you have got grace, grace will teach you, it will instruct you that you should say no, you should deny worldliness. You should deny ungodliness. You should deny worldliness. And you go home. Somebody will come and say, oh, when you deny worldliness, that becomes your work. You are denying worldliness. Why should Christ die on the cross? You are under grace. You don't deny anything. You live as God. We should live as the kings and queens on the earth. We, the Lord has made us kings. We are the royal priesthood. You know what the dress of the priest? All the breastplate, his outer coat, inner coat, his attire and the gold plate. You are the priest. You come to the church. You hear what grace is in a different way. In the church you may hear, don't adorn yourselves with silver and gold. Jewels is not biblical. And somebody will come and say, we must wear jewels. It's good to have different opinions. But if it is contrary to what you have learned in the church, when you know it is contrary, avoid them. It is untoward. It is right or wrong. Let heaven judge. Let heaven judge. And if you feel the teaching what you have got in the church is wrong, you come and talk with me. You come and talk with me. Yet if you are confirmed the teaching here is wrong, you make your own choice. The Spirit of the Lord is in me. I know very well. I don't hide any good teaching from you. What I know right, what I believe, what my wife and I believe, what we tell our children, what we want our grandchildren to practice, we share that with the church. We share that with the church. When you know it is contrary to what you have learned, avoid them. Run away from them. Don't show more interest, a second look at those type of teachings. They are untoward. They are right or wrong is a different thing. They are untoward. They are contrary to what you have learned. That's why in John, 2 John, when we read from verse 8 to 11, 2 John from verse 8 to 11, look to yourselves that we lose not those things which we have wrought, but that we receive a full reward. Whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. If there come any unto you, and bring not this doctrine, they say Christ, they show you a number of verses. Jesus prayed to the Father. So Jesus is not the Father. Jesus died on the cross. God cannot die. Jesus said he is the Son of Man. He is only Son of Man. They'll bring you different doctrines. What you have not heard. I don't have time to show you a number of verses. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, if you read from first three verses, you are betrothed as a virgin to one husband, Jesus Christ. Paul says, I am afraid that your heart should not be deceived from the subtlety of the devil. How? If somebody brings a different doctrine, and you'll endure it patiently, that your heart will be turned away from your faithfulness to Jesus. When you accept different doctrine. So here John says, the loving disciple says, if any come unto you and bring not this doctrine, Receive him not into your house. Neither bid him Godspeed. Don't say shalom to him. Somebody is bringing an erroneous doctrine. Don't say God bless you. My dear brother, my dear sister, you must come to the Bible studies regularly, attend the morning service, the evening service, and also meet your pastor, pastorma, the senior people, discuss the doctrine. You must be thorough with the word of God. Otherwise, the devil will deceive you. People with erroneous teachings will deceive you. When we were in Annanagar, one day, I was just standing at the gate, a house gate. One lady, well-dressed, seemed to be a good educator. She came to me, a good English. She said, we are coming from Christian Science. Sir, shall we talk to you for some time? So I know the Christian Science, Watchtower, Jehovah's Witnesses, they are one and the same in different ploy names. So when she said she is from Christian Sciences, I said, you want to talk to me? She said, yes. I said, before I could ask you to come in, shall I ask you one question? She said, yes, sir. The Bible says, God manifested in flesh. Has it happened or not it happened? You believe the Bible. The Bible says God has manifested in flesh. Devan mamsathile velipatta. Has it happened or has not it happened? Sir, I'll come some other time. Immediately he said, the curse of the Lord will be upon you. If you go from house to deceive people, the curse of the Lord will be upon you. Up to her face, I said. நீங்க வீடு வீடா போய் ஜனங்களை மோசம் போக்கீர்களானால் தேவ சாபம் உங்கள் மேல் இருக்கும். I didn't curse her. Just asked one question. She said, sir, நான் அப்புறம் வரேன். My dear brother, my dear sister, when they bring a different doctrine, don't be very good enough to say, oh, God bless you. How can God bless somebody with an erroneous teachings? If at all you are really concerned about those people, help them. Before I could say this, I asked the sister, come in, sister, I'll talk to you, I tell you what the Bible says. She didn't know that I was a pastor, or rather I was a preacher. So Ananaga, some man, some professional is standing. So she just used the word Christian Science. My dear brother, my dear sister, don't say the Godspeed to them. Verse 11, for he that biddeth him Godspeed is partaker of his evil deeds. If you watch that TV program, if you receive those people, sit and talk to them, even at least you say, God bless you, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, brother. How can you praise God for that man? Who is sowing the seeds of division, who is bringing an erroneous teaching, causing divisions, contrary to what you have learned, contrary to what you have taught, what you have learned from the church, where the Lord has placed you. When you say, praise the Lord, brother, how can you praise God for that person who is sowing the seeds of division? In other words, we are atrocious enough, we are arrogant enough to praise God for somebody who is teaching wrong things. Am I right? We are doing it not willfully, but ignorantly. How can I praise God somebody who is preaching wrong things? How can I send money to a program that teaches wrong things? Can I say they are also right and we are also right? Can we say 2 plus 2 is also 5, 2 plus 2 is also 3? Nay, we can't say that. Either 2 plus 2 is 4, or 2 plus 2 is 3, or 2 plus 2 is 5. We can't say all three are the same. You are also right, I am also right. This is a very dangerous. Escape from Sodom and Gomorrah and escape to the mountain the Lord shows to you. Escape to the church the Lord has given you. The church is your adakala pattanam. It is your adakala pattanam. It is where you find your asylum. The Lord has prepared a place for you. This is where you are protected. My dear brother, my dear sister, somebody says, we are conducting youth program because your pastor doesn't do it. Because there's no youth program in your church. What is erroneous there? From Genesis to Revelation, and especially in the New Testament, in the Gospels, or in the Epistles, we don't see anywhere the Lord is calling somebody and says, the church is not doing such and such thing. You conduct a youth program, you conduct a child ministry, you conduct this, you conduct that. We don't read anywhere in the Bible. We don't read anywhere in the Bible. Instead, they are conducting youth program, they can start a new church. They can take the responsibility of the souls. We see a lot of parachurch activities. Parachurch activities. Just to make the people believe as a slow poison, your pastor is useless. The church you are going is useless. They don't have a program for you. Slowly, 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 making them lose interest in their own churches. To make them think that, to belittle their pastors in the eyes of those people. It's a devil's device. I'm not speaking about our church. We don't have any problem. I don't have anybody in mind. I'm honest. But we are in the last days. In different ways, the devil is injecting poison in the church. Somebody is running a team. The Lord has not asked him to gather people, youth from all the different churches, and to conduct a youth program. What is the message? Your pastor is useless. The church you are going there is useless. That's not a good church. They don't have a program for you. Only we give program for you. Only we give conduct program for the children. My dear brother, my dear sister. In these last days, number one, escape from the city, escape to the mountain. Number one, escape from anything that's untoward. Anything contrary to what you have learned in the church. My dear brother, my dear sister, this is the way, walk here. When you know that what is taught in the church where God has placed you, if you feel that it's not right, go and talk with that pastor. Any church meeting, talk with that pastor. Help that pastor if he is wrong. If you are wrong, correct yourself. Or you know the Lord is leading you in a different way, choose that path. But grow in one teaching. My dear brother, my dear sister, don't say like Lord, oh Lord, no, no, I want this teaching, I want that teaching. No, my dear brother, my dear sister, escape yourself from anything that is untoward. Number two, this is very, very important. For your own edification, I say, is not to hurt you, to make you understand, to make our children understand. I took a lot of pains. It's not from a sermon book I'm bringing out some sermons. You know how much time I spent waiting in the presence of God. It's a real sacrifice. It's a real spirit of martyrdom. Spirit of martyrdom. When we are waiting in the presence of God and meditating on His words, it will appear as if the brains will blow out sometime. You read about the prophets. You read about the prophet. God tells Ezekiel, you lie down like this for so many days. You lie down like that for so many days. The Lord tells Ezekiel, eat bread that is made out of the fire, variety of human excretion. That's the only one place Ezekiel said, Lord, it's too much. Make variety with human excretion, and on that make a bread and eat. The Lord told the prophet, there's the only one place Ezekiel said, Lord, it's too much. The Lord wanted Ezekiel to say that. Then Lord said, make it out of cow dung. Bringing a message, bringing out a prophecy, it's not a joke. At least for your pastor, it's not a joke. Somebody said, 5 minutes I can preach on any verse. I can't do it. My fever starts maybe mostly all through the week, and it rises, it soars high. Maybe Thursday, Friday, Saturday, it will be to the peak. It will be to the peak. I may not love to see anybody. I may not love to answer the phone calls. Why I say this? We take a lot of pains and bring this message to you that you should escape Sodom and escape to the mountain the Lord has prepared for you. The second one is very, very important. 1 Corinthians 6:18. Make a note of it, please. 1 Corinthians 6:18. Flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body. But he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. Flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body. But he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. 1 Thessalonians 4:3. Please make a note. 1 Thessalonians 4:3. For this is the will of God, even your sanctification. This is the will of God, even your sanctification, that you should abstain from fornication. That you should abstain from fornication. So a very shallow explanation about fornication, adultery, uncleanness, lasciviousness, sex perversion, all those things we have discussed. I want to hit the nail on the head. I want to really understand what the Bible says about fornication. Though I know it, to bring it to our boys and girls, our brothers and sisters, even to the senior people here, even those who are across 90, those who are across 90, God told Abraham, walk before me and be upright. Be perfect. Walk before me and be perfect. When he was 99 years old, the Lord told him, when 90 years old, the Lord told him, walk before me and be perfect. Genesis chapter 17. This is for our holiness. This is for our sanctification. This is the will of God, that you should abstain from fornication. So in the modern dictionary, what is fornication? The modern dictionary definition of fornication is voluntary. I compared two or three dictionaries and brought out this definition. The modern dictionary definition of fornication is voluntary and consensual sexual relationship between man and women not married to each other. In a broader sense, what do you understand by fornication? A voluntary, consensual, both give a consent to it. It's not rape. It's not forced on somebody. Both yield to it. Are voluntary on one side. So here it says, it's a voluntary, consensual sexual relationship between man and women, or between two persons, man and man, women and women, gays, lesbians, between two persons, not married to each other. It includes adultery. What we say adultery is generally included in the broader term fornication. Fornications come from a Latin word where the prostitutes will stand under a shade, something like a sunshade or a kure, and protects their customers from rain or sunshine. A top that is called the fornica. So later in the Latin, that word has come for fornication. Any sexual relationship outside marriage is called fornication. And adultery is again voluntary and consensual sexual relationship between a married person and a partner, other than the lawful spouse of opposite sex. What we call adultery is again a fornication, a consensual sex relationship with a man or woman other than the lawful married spouse, other than the husband or the wife. You have got relationship with any other person, with the same sex or an opposite sex, a sexual relationship. That is called adultery. Here, adultery is a subdivision of fornication. In adultery, one of the partners or one of the perpetrators, one of the perpetrators or both the perpetrators are married to somebody else. They are married, already married. That is adultery. So the Lord says, flee from fornication. So what is fornication? Sex relationship. Any form. Either it is in the thought form, or just touch form, or just only hugging, or only just kissing, or only just caressing the hand, or only thinking, in any form, just as an expression of sex, rolling the lips, any form. So sex relationship in any form outside lawful monogamous married to one person, monogamous marriage between a man and a woman, not man and a man, not women and women, between a man and a woman is biblically sin. Our New Testament life practice comes from the Old Testament laws. Probably David could not understand the law. Only in the Malachi we read the proper interpretation for Mosaic law. But we read in the book of Leviticus, we read in the book of Deuteronomy, all these things very clearly written. Very clearly written. So Jesus didn't bring a new teaching. Jesus threw more light on the law. According to law of Moses or law of the land, suppose you want to kill somebody or shoot at him. Your aim is bad. Or he ducks fast. You are shooting at him. He is not killed. Then you are not a murderer. Because he didn't die. If he died, you become a murderer. If he didn't die, you are not a murderer. You attempt to murder, but you didn't murder him. But Jesus said, no, that's wrong. Whether your aim is good or bad, whether that person is able to duck or not, the moment you hate him, you have become a murderer. You are a murderer when the time comes, you murder. So whether you murder or not, whether the person dies or not, the moment you hate him, you become a murderer. Because you become a murderer, when the time comes, you murder. Apply the same principle. It's not that a boy lies with a girl. It's not that the boy makes her naked and sleeps with her. Then only he committed adultery or fornication. So Jesus said, it's not like that. The moment you lust her in your eyes, you become an adulterer, fornicator. You become a fornicator. When the time comes, when you get an opportunity, maybe a lonely time, when you are able to, she is able to call you home and she is alone. She phones and says, my mommy, daddy are not here. You come home. You go there. You become a perpetrator. You perform that crime. Why did you perform that crime? Because you are a fornicator. When did you become a fornicator? When you lusted her in your eyes. When you lusted her in your eyes, you become an adulterer. If you get an opportunity, probably you see a sinister, or you see a model, or somebody lusted that person, that Mr. Handsome, she lusted that person, or that cricketer, She lusts at that person. She may not have an opportunity to perpetrate that sin. Because she didn't get an opportunity to perpetrate that sin, she's not holy. Only she hasn't got an opportunity to perpetrate that sin is very remote. She was yearning for that, or he was yearning for that. He may have fascination. That's because an adulterer, because a fornicator. This married fellow, he lusts at another woman. He's an adulterer. He doesn't have the guts to go and sleep with her. He's afraid that her husband, Cherupal Adipanene, because he's afraid to perpetrate that act, he's not holy. He is more a coward. He doesn't have the guts to perpetrate that crime. Or he is scared that he would go to hell. He is scared that he would go to hell. Please listen. Allow to help you. The moment you hate somebody, you become a murderer. Whether you murder him or not, when the opportunity comes, he may murder. And when you attempt to murder also, that person can escape. Or your aim can go wrong, but you are a murderer in the sight of God. That's why Jesus threw more light on this. It's not a question whether you sleep with somebody or not, whether you get that opportunity or not, whether you got the guts to do it or not. But the moment you desired in your heart, you became a fornicator, because it's outside your marriage. Whatever the world may say, I'm just sharing with you the Bible standard. Whether the Bible is right or wrong, it's left to you. What the world says may be contrary to this. Yes, the world is always contrary to the Bible. My dear brother, my dear sister, so what is the Greek word Paul was using here, Peter was using here, is porneia, P-O-R-N, E-I-A, pornia. From that only we get the word porn, pornography, porn movies, hot. Porn. What is pornia? The very simple word pornia means, the Greek word, you'll surprise to know, unlawful lust. The literal meaning of the word pornia, porn movies, pornography, hot films, hot films, means simply unlawful lust, pornia. It comes from the root meaning unlawful lust. It's not a lawful lust. It is unlawful. My dear brother, my dear sister, fornication includes premarital sex. As I said, in any form, premarital sex, either in the thought area, it is fantasy sex. That person is absent, thinking about the person and performing that act, fantasy sex. I speak to you openly, it is sin. It is sin. You have got your sex when you think about a film star or Mr. Hanson or some model or somebody in your college or a neighbor's wife or somebody's husband. It is fantasy sex, it's sin. Whether you like it or not, it is sin. In any form. It's not that we are lying together. It's not that I haven't made her naked. Whether thinking or touching or caressing or kissing or hugging or lying together. The worst form, having an intercourse. With a protection or without a protection, it's a sin. Can somebody say that I got intercourse with protection, that's why it's not a sin? Rubbish. Nonsense. Sin is a sin in any form. Sin is a sin in any form. So here it says, premarital relationship, sex, adultery, outside marital relationship after marriage, homosexuality, gays and lesbians, incest, having relationship which the very nature forbids, relationship with parents, relationship with children, relationship with co-bonds, relationship with those who are very close to us, other than husbands. That's called incest. That's a form of fornication. It includes premarital sex, adultery, homosexuality, incest, remarriage after unbiblical divorce because you lusted somebody. You wanted to divorce your earlier husband or wife. That may not be applicable to many of us here. And bestiality is having sex with animals. That includes even hugging a teddy bear with a sex drive, hugging a soft doll with a sex drive, that may be even a pillow. The Spirit of the Lord wants me to help you. Please bear with me. The Lord wants me to help you. Come out in any form, both in act and thought. We had to flee from that in 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 22. Flee also youthful lust, but follow righteousness, faith and charity, peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. So this is the core of the message. Flee from Sodom, escape from Sodom, and escape to the mountain God shows. Escape from this youthful lust. Escape from this sin. All other sins is outside your body. But this sin you can commit only with your body. Your body will go to hell. My dear brother, my dear sister, your risen body will go to hell. I want to bring you to the pure teaching. So here, Paul says, tells Timothy, flee from these things. When you flee from these things, follow righteousness, faith and charity, peace, with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. A good spiritual fellowship, who can pray for you, where the fire is burning. Where the fire is burning, go and join there. Prayer life. Just coming to the church, giving the attendance is not going to help you, brother, help you, sister. I'm not here to condemn you, I'm here to help you. The Lord is faithful enough to forgive you. The Lord will give you grace. When I was 21 years old, I got saved. A normal person with a good health. I was a hockey player. I was an intercollegiate secretary. I was good at elocution and dramatics. A normal health. Good English. Language power. Why I say this? The Lord protected me. In the presence of God, I say. In the presence of God, I say. But I love to tell you one thing. You may not be able to stop crows flying over your head. There are besetting sins. Many times you might have made a mistake. We all have made mistakes. So Sadhu Sundar Singh once said, you cannot stop crows flying over your heads. But with all humility I praise God. With all humility I praise God. Never, never, never God allowed any crow to build its nest on my head. My dear brother, my dear sister, I praise God for such a wife the Lord has also given me. Whatever your past may be, today make a decision. Today make a decision. Flee from fornication. The Lord desires your sanctification. Escape fornication. Escape from fornication and escape the holy fellowship. If there have been crows flying over your heads, if there have been besetting sins, don't be discouraged. But today take a decision. I flee from. My dear brother, my dear sister, somebody is in a bus. A sin is very close by him. He doesn't need to close his eyes and say, yes, way. The Bible says, don't pray. Don't say, yes, way. It's a blasphemy. The Bible says, flee from that place. Move away from that place. The sin is not in the body. The sin is in your thought. The sin is what importance you give to that. Just to give a practical situation. Somebody is standing in a crowded bus. A very soft skin is caressing him, is pressing him. He enjoys. He eats. He thinks it was some woman with a very soft skin. The same situation, he just turns to see. It was a person with a leprosy. The soft skin is a leprosy-infected skin. Immediately, repulsively, he moves. It's not the touch, it is your evil mind. It is not the touch, your evil mind. That pleasure, that lust is in the mind. You thought that skin was somebody else's. You saw that skin belonged to somebody else. You moved away. When your thought is set with the Lord, you flee from the lust. You flee from the lust. My dear brother, my dear sister, for your blessing I say, flee from any teaching that is contrary to what you have learned in the church. Flee from fornication, youthful lust. Try and flee from it. Surely the Lord will help you. Surely the Lord will help you. We all have problems. Many years back, one sincere person, one who wants to escape from Sodom, he phoned me. Said, when I'm just going through the internet, it's my office duty. When I go through some programs, accidentally, some porn sites are opening. I'm unable to resist. But he wanted to resist. He wanted to flee from that. He openly shared with me. I prayed with him. I encouraged. Don't fight. Believe. Your deliverance is in faith. Your deliverance is not fighting against it. Your deliverance is faith. God who has delivered you will deliver you. Today he is serving the Lord mightily. I don't say there will be no besetting sins. I don't want to condemn you for besetting sins. If somebody justifies that, I tell you, you are not escaping from Sodom. Escape from Sodom. Escape to the mountain. Number 3. Flee from idolatry. 1 Corinthians 10:14. Wherefore, before that, This word fornication in the Bible given for two things. Literally fornication, what we meditated. And also fornication is given for worldly idolatry. Worldly idolatry. In both in the Old Testament and New Testament, especially in the book of Revelation, fornication is given for worshipping idols. Following other religions, other religious practices, type of having a Babylonian festival in the name of Christ. It's a type of a spiritual fornication. Loving Christ and loving the world, James says adultery. Adulterer and adulteress, those who have got Christ plus. Those who have got Christ plus. They want the world and they want Christ. They are married to Christ and also they love the world. That's adultery. So this adultery, fornication, is also given in a figurative form. Glory be to the Lord's holy name. I move quickly to number 3, idolatry. Wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry. 1 John 5:21. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. So this also I want you to understand in two different ways. Any practice that is connected with the idolatries or any connected with the pagan rituals at funeral, at marriage, anything that's connected with the idolatry or pagan rituals, the traditions of the world, we should be dead to it. Literally, we should flee from that. We should flee from that. That's a Christian idolatry, pagan worship, or a Hindu pagan worship. See, one of her relatives, she died. Her husband was left alone. So we were helping the whole funeral thing. The next day was the funeral, we were with them. When the funeral, everything was over, just we went to home for just a rest. Next early morning, we wanted to go and help them. Just wanted to see that uncle. Early morning when I went there, a few of the relatives were there. I said, where is uncle? They are hardcore Pentecostals. Where's the uncle? Somebody told me, uncle, kalariki poirukkar. ஆண்டி தான் நேற்று கல்லறைக்கு போனாங்க, இன்னைக்கு எதுக்கு அங்கிள் கல்லறைக்கு போனார், அங்கிள் கல்லறைக்கு போயிருக்காரு. I thought it was a type of a fascination. She just wanted the place where her mortals remain were buried. It was foolishness, okay, but anyway, an emotion. Somebody let the cat out. அங்கிள் பால் ஊற்ற போயிருக்கார். What nonsense it is. Chettaachi bari paniyaachi. And the aalukku moona, appuram dhaan we calculate, it was the third day. First day buried, died, second day buried. We were there for the funeral. Oh, this is the third day. This hardcore Pentecostal gone to Palvutha. What nonsense it is. We are not dead to these type of practices. We are not dead to these type of practices. They are all based on some idol worship, some spirit worship. It was a fear that that person should not come home. What a love it is. So we go and give milk to that spirit there. What a waste of milk. My dear brother, my dear sister, a lot of idolatries, idol worships. We want to have a cross. We believe that cross would protect us. Just a wooden cross, or a paper cross, or a gold cross. Want to have a thali. In the thali you must have a cross. It's an idol. In the window they want to have a cross. In that grill work, otherwise the devil will come in. It's an idol. Flee from idolatry. There was a leading Pentecostal church. On the top, they had that inverted U and a cross in between. I met that pastor. Pastor, you got this cross. Inside that inverted U. You know what is that inverted U? Yes, Pastor, I know. I miss it. I invited him to preach here. I thought that he didn't know about it. So when I was sitting in the room and I asked, Pastor, do you know what is that? What's that? That inverted U is nothing but the human male organ in erection. That's the lingam. It's the worshipping of the male organ. He wanted to keep it on the top of the prayer house and put a cross underneath. Christian idol. He didn't want to destroy that even after he knew that was an orgy. That was an orgy. He didn't want to remove it. He said, Kattiya chapter remove it. Now he wanted to do an extension, well, some foreign aid king, he broke it. I don't know what evil, what ugly thing he has got there now, I don't know. I don't have any contact with him after that. It's an orgy. He wants to keep it on the top of the prayer house. The human organ which was worshipped by the pagans in a Christian form. Whatever the idolatry, maybe a cross, or maybe an idol, or maybe something to do with the chanting, you are keeping it very safe. But it is an idol. I remember, I don't know whether media people could help, there was an exclusive message what I preached many years ago. No to Christian idols. If we can get that CD, message. I try to make a CD out of it and give you. No to Christian idols. When I was in Annanagar, I preached. If anybody, I don't know, Dr. Arime Raj, anybody has got that cassette, they can bring that cassette to me. No to Christian idols. My dear brother, my dear sister, more than that, what is idolatry? In Colossians chapter 3 verse 5, Colossians 3, 5, mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence and covetousness which is idolatry. Covetousness which is idolatry. Purulas. For some people, even when just they kneel down and close their eyes, only these idols will be in front of them. That purul, that material thing. That's their idol. For some people, the children, a husband, wife, they're idols, they're icons. Even in their prayer, that will be in front of them. When they kneel down, that will be in front of them. When they close their eyes, it will be before them. When they open their eyes, it will be before them. In their dreams, it will be with them. Dear children, beloved children, Paul says, beloved children, flee from idolatry in any form, literally or figuratively. I got 10 points to share with you today, suffice for these three. But we love you all very much. I love you all very much. With real love and affection. With that concern for your souls. With a concern for your soul. As we have to stand for your souls. That you should inherit the kingdom of God with us. I'm sharing with this word, sharing with you pure word of God. Any doctrine contrary to what you have learned, flee from that. Fornication in any form, flee from that. Idolatry, literally, culturally, or figuratively, flee from that. That you are not consumed. That you are not consumed. Nee aliyada padiki. Flee from Sodom and flee to the mountain the Lord shows. Flee from all these evil things and flee to spiritual fellowship, to your prayer, to your meditation on the word of God with all those who serve the Lord with holiness. All those who move towards perfection. All those who wait for the return of the Lord. Lord said, O Lord, no. O Lord, no. He made a fatal mistake. Moab, Ammon were born to him because of that incest, his sex relationship with his own daughters. That's called incest. Shall we close our eyes? This is a lesson for me. This is a lesson to Abraham, who was 99 years old. Walk before me and be upright. Walk before me and be upright. Escape from Soda. Escape to the holy mountain. Shall we pray?